question. Okay, so the first question is, why do you believe or not in spiritual bodies? And this is in reference to a line I pulled out of your blog. Just to quote you, you say, first, and this is of central importance, we will be raised from the dead. We will have spiritual bodies. So I'll let you set that up and then we'll have a chat
okay,
about that.
Okay, this comes in the context of what I mentioned. I'm working on the virtue of hope. Now, there's a great deal of material written by philosophers of all sorts, theists and non-theists alike, and I appreciate what I'm learning from them. But in this particular essay, I'm asking in particular about what is Christian hope? And so I'm just trying to be true to the scriptures. And so in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul says unequivocally that the Christian hope is rooted in the resurrection of the body. And then he uses this phrase that just drives people crazy, drives me crazy. What in the world is a spiritual body? Sometimes Christians have an idea that our hope is very Platonic, that you die and your soul flies away to be with Jesus. It's an amazing amount of Christians who believe this, when really it's just Plato and it's not Paul at all. Paul says that our hope is that we will be resurrected and we will have, then he has this phrase that I've already pointed out, spiritual bodies. Do I know what they are? No.
Nobody does.
Nobody does.
No Christian theologian does. They all disagree and argue.
Well, and good for them. When we don't know, we should argue about it. And we should admit that we don't know. Does that mean, for instance, does not knowing what a spiritual body is in detail, does that mean the doctrine is somehow unbelievable or it's confused or self-contradictory? If it was self-contradictory, then it would be unbelievable, but it's not.
But it seems like it's not only not in detail, it's kind of like the only thing that's in common is the actual word, spiritual body. I mean, because once you define it, that's where everything goes off the rails.
Well, Paul doesn't define it either, and he's not a scientist, but he's giving, he gives metaphors and similes to, he says, of, for instance, of wheat, that the seed falls into the ground and dies, and what you get is different. It's a plant. All right. He says, there are different kinds of flesh, the flesh of birds and fish and everything. Okay, there are different kinds. His idea, the thing that he's trying to really get across, comes in the famous line that gets repeated over and over again in the Messiah, and we shall be changed, so that our spiritual body, in order, it would have to be me, but it would have to be changed. So with those, that now that doesn't tell you what it is, but it gives you broad parameters among inside of which the argument has to go.
That's one reason why I left the faith, though, is because I don't think it makes sense to even think of, when you say it would be me, there's so many ways to think that doesn't even make sense. Like, for example, a baby that's miscarried, so it's not even born yet.
Yeah.
What is that baby in heaven? I mean, there's no such thing as a person because a person progresses through age. I mean, you know, and then the other side is, what about a senile old person? Sometimes they say, well, you're not going to be senile in heaven. Well, then that wouldn't be you, because if you go back 20 years when you're prime of your life, you're a different person. You have different ideas and thoughts. So there is no you that's really a person
now,
anyway.
How far are you going to take this idea that, you see, what you are denying is the idea that there's personal identity over time?
No, I think personal identity is just a model, a mental model of you make of yourself. Like, who am I as Bernie? I work here, I have a spouse, and that changes over time.
Is Bernie the same person who was before his, what shall we say, his deconversion?
No, I'm constantly changing.
You are not the same person.
Yeah, my name stays the same.
Uh-huh.
But so my thoughts and everything are different.
Is it then unjust for us to punish people for the crimes they committed before they were converted? Now they are converted and they're not the same person.
Yeah, I believe people have consequences. Mm-hmm.
So it is just to punish, because it is the same person, even though there's been radical change between them.
I think this might go in the equivocation where basically you use the same word to mean different things.
No, it isn't. We're talking about what does it mean to be the same person over time, and especially over wide gaps of time. Paul died in the first century, and we assume that you don't assume, Christians assume, I don't want to put words in your mouth, that on Resurrection Day, Paul himself will be resurrected. Thousands of years who knows, resurrection day could be 10,000 years from now. So there would be this tremendous gap of time, or at least from my perspective would be, between me dying in, let's say, 2035, let's give me some years, and the resurrection day a long time from now. And this is a real problem because many people, Christians and non-Christians alike, will say, that's impossible. There cannot, unless there is something that ties me here to me then, it's not the same me. It's a personal identity problem. So here's the problem. We still have 4 minutes. This is great. This is one of the things we do. You know Star Trek.
Sure.
And you have the Star Trek crazy, it doesn't actually work physically, but the transportation.
Transporter room, yeah.
Right. So invent something better than that. We have this little room over here.
Yeah.
You can walk in and the room will scan you down to the atomic level.
Right.
And in order to scan you and reduce you to computer bits, you know, ones and zeros, it destroys you.
Right, right.
So there's nothing there. Mm-hmm. But on Mars, they receive the microwave information, and on Mars, they have a machine with a good supply of hydrogen and oxygen and a few trace minerals,
right.
And they use this information to reconstruct you after a span of 2 seconds.
Right, right.
Would you walk into the machine?
Yeah, I mean, that there's that exact thought experiment is in the book.
Oh, it's big in the literature.
Have you heard of the philosophy book? It's got a lot of philosophical thought stories in it. I think it's called The Duck That Won the Lottery. Have you heard of that?
No, I haven't heard this. But the idea is common.
Yeah.
There's lots of it.
Right.
So would you walk into the machine? See how it relates to the philosophical problem. Does the Bernie who walks in here and is destroyed, is he the same person who walks out of the machine on Mars 2 seconds later?
Actually, I think we're like destroyed every second. I mean, I'm always, the Bernie that was here 5 minutes ago is gone now.
Uh-huh. Is there personal identity? Is the Bernie that you are now, you're in love with the young man who was learning to run this machine. You know, you.
So my
your
son.
Your son. Okay. That
just
young
to be
man.
Clear here.
Oh yeah. Well, I'm not accusing you of anything like that.
Yeah, okay.
No. So you have a love relationship with a person, and time goes by. Are you still in love with that person, or is it you? Who is in love with that person? Just the person who was there 5 minutes ago, or the you now?
Yeah, but see, when you say me, that's still my mental image of who I am. Uh-huh. I have a mental image of myself, and I have a mental image of you.
Uh-huh.
You are who I made an mental image of you. I mean, there's Phil. You have a different you because you think of yourself differently. Everybody thinks of you a little differently. Well,
but you see how personal identity doesn't just function in Christian hope. It functions in science fiction analogy. Would it be the real you that gets out over there?
That's a good question.
And it functions in our legal system because we punish one another for what we did a long time ago.
Yeah, but and also the punishments vary depending on what you know. For example, if somebody lies, are they really guilty of lying if they don't know any better? Well, you know, like for example, if somebody killed somebody accidentally, it's different than killing somebody on purpose.
Of course, we have different levels of responsibility for wrongdoing.
And if somebody's retarded, you don't hold them to the same accountability as you do somebody who's very smart.
So now, Fred commits a crime. He is fully in command of his faculties, and he just wants money, so he defrauds his neighbors and makes millions of dollars, and he's caught at it and convicted and goes to prison. Mm-hmm. In prison, one of the people who he defrauded, who hates him very much, bashes him over the head, and Fred suffers a terrible brain injury.
Mm-hmm.
He can't remember anything.
Mm-hmm.
He's not able, he'll never commit fraud again because he's too stupid.
Right.
Is it right for us to keep Fred in prison?
I would say at that point, what's the point of having him in prison if he's not going to, if he's for sure not going to do it again and he doesn't remember it and all that?
Okay.
He's a different person now.
He's
right?
a different person, so he's not guilty anymore.
It's just like, what's the point of putting him in prison?
Those are two different questions. The justification of prison is a different question than whether he's guilty or not.
Yeah, I mean, he's still guilty, but...
Because he's the same person.
But the question is, what do you do about it?
We've pushed to the end. Okay, that was a good question.
This
is fun.
You're the first guest I've ever had that was able to watch the clock. That's nice.
Well, this
usually
is wonderful.
I'm trying to say, like, we're out of time.
We're having fun.
You.